Having your mom always nagging you to do your homework, take out the trash, or make your bed might feel like a torture. But it's nothing compared to growing up in the Middle Ages, where by the age of 14 you might have kids of your own. That's right, today we are testing your survival chance if you were born in the Middle Ages. So, you are just born, your parents are overjoyed that you are alive, now what? Well, you shouldn't put down your guard because the first year of life is one of the most dangerous, with as many as 50% of children succumbing to death. The infant mortality rate was sky high in the Middle Ages. During this year, you'll be cared for and nursed either by your mother, if the family belonged to the peasant class, or by a wet nurse if the family belonged to a noble class. Breastfeeding was the only option for feeding babies in the Middle Ages, and it was normal for children to be breastfed well beyond 2 years of age. If we assume you were to be born in a noble class family, besides wet nurse and nanny, chances are very high you would also have a cradle rocker. Some high status women found it too much of hard work the thought of rocking their child to sleep. So the Middle Ages came up with the ideal real job, an official cradle rocker. I mean, I'm not entirely knocking it, that must have been nice and arguably the most boring occupation in all of world history. If we assume you were born in a peasant class family, however, you are definitely out of luck when it comes to servants who would pamper you. In most cases, you would be taken care either by your mother or another female relative or neighbor in case the mother died in childbirth, since peasants didn't often have the luxury of hiring a full-time nurse. Medieval peasant parents sometimes found alternatives to breastfeeding their children, but there is no evidence that this was a common occurrence. Rather, families resorted to such ingenuity when the mother was dead or too ill to breastfeed, and when no wet nurse could be found. Alternate methods of feeding the child included soaking bread in milk for the child to ingest, soaking a rag in milk for the child to suckle, or pouring milk into his mouth from a horn. If for whatever reason the baby could not be nursed, his chances of contracting illness increased. This was due to the unsanitary methods devised for getting food into him and the lack of beneficial breast milk to help him fight disease. Peasant mothers who had their hands full with daily chores were sometimes unable to keep a constant watch on their offspring, and it was not unknown for them to leave their infants or toddlers unattended. Court records illustrate that this practice was not very common and met with disapproval in the community at large. Magistrate records show accidental deaths of infants from falling out of their cribs or being strangled by hanging cords were quite common. Children succumb to other dangers as well. In cultures that practice swaddling infants or tying them into a cradle to keep them out of trouble, babies were known to die in fires when they were so confined. Parents would also warn not to sleep with their infant children for fear of overlaying and smothering them. If you survived the first year, then congratulations, you are one of the 50% who made it. Growing up and acquiring new skills makes you also more mobile and ready for adventures, which immediately equals new ways to end your life prematurely. If you are part of the peasant family, and you are one of those naughty toddlers that like to explore the world around, much to the dismay of your parents, more likely than not, you would be tied to your mother by way of a string from her apron, so you wouldn't run around and injure yourself. During this time of development, in Middle Ages were registered frequent cases of toddlers' deaths from falling off the stairs, falling in a well, or being run by a cart on the street. Parents provided care and training, and records of fatal accidents to small children suggest that boys and girls soon became aware of their gender and followed their gender parent in daily tasks. Accidents to small girls often took place around firesides or wells, and those to small boys in the father's working space. If you are lucky to be born in a royal family, the chances of these types of deaths decrease, since there is always someone to take care of you. Wealthy parents in the Middle Ages hired a member of house staff known as a groomer to follow toddlers around, steering them away from messy situations and helping to ensure their expensive clothes stay clean and dry. Now for the next part, I'm hoping you are not eating. No matter whether you are born in peasant or royal family, the facts are medieval people didn't have blenders, so they had to be creative when it comes to softening solid food for their toddlers. Mothers or nurses, if the mother was too poor to do it herself, would pre-chew food to ensure it was soft and mushy before feeding it to the child. Yes? And like that, toddlerhood is over. Here I come, childhood. Now here we have a few possible ways to go. First, depends on the family upbringing, whether they are rich or poor, and also from the gender of the child. When it comes to peasant families, children were given tasks in keeping with their ages. For younger children, this meant looking after their smaller siblings or running errands. As they grew older, they might be allocated lighter domestic or agricultural duties, but they were not capable of doing serious work until about the age of puberty, when they began to acquire strength of an adult kind. Growing up also involved acquaintance with religion. Parents and godparents were expected to teach them basic prayers in Latin and how to behave in church. Church law after the 12th century asked little of children in terms of duties. Only when they reached puberty did they acquire the adult obligations of confessing to a priest at least once a year, attending church and paying church dues. With that being said, peasant boys had two paths to follow, either becoming church representatives or following their father's footsteps. Some boys were able to attend local cathedral or monastic schools to learn the trivium and quadrivium. Usually these boys were being groomed to become members of clergy, either in the lower orders, as clerks, as priests, or in the higher positions, such as bishops, doctors, or lawyers. These boys might also have been dedicated to the monastic life by their parents, who would give the monastery a donation to secure the place. The minimum age of acceptance in the monastery, according to surviving documents, would be around 4 to 5 years. This wasn't a way to get rid of children, although there were always some cases in which parents couldn't afford to raise them, but rather a spiritual commitment stemming from the very fact that children were the most precious things parents had to offer to God. Also, in a pragmatic sense, it did allow the church to invest in and nurture the child accordingly. It would be easier for the child to become accustomed to the monastic lifestyle at the age of 5 or 6. At this age, they would probably not be too young to learn and obey, but not too old to have independent and formed personality that may make them resistant to accepting the way of life required of them by the monastery. Girls were also given to convents in the same way to spend their lives in cloistered seclusion. However, it was less common, since the widely accepted role of a woman in the medieval society was to bear children. So they were raised by their mothers to do exactly this, taking care of the house, clean, cook, raise their younger siblings. The higher class had some different approach when raising the children. Noble boys were often fostered in other households where they might receive the training they needed to become successful adults. Boys as young as 7 began training for knighthood with wooden swords, bows, and small horses or ponies, learning by doing and by watching the knights with whom they lived. They also learned to read and sometimes write in both their native tongues and in Latin. Royal boys had intensive education and battle training, fit for future ruler of a country. Girls were taught from girlhood to run their households, as they would on behalf of their future husbands whenever they were absent. This meant understanding everything from budgeting to delegating, making clothes by hand, throwing a feast for hundreds. When it comes to royals, girls also received basic education, but it wasn't so developed as for boys. Instead, girls were taught language, reading, writing, literature, music, and of course, the Bible. However, in some countries like England, sending children away to live and work in someone else's home, binding them generally for another 7 or 9 years, was common practice regardless of their class. Everyone, however rich he may be, sends away his children into the house of others, while at least he, in return, receives those of strangers into his own. Venetian traveler from 15th century pointed that out. Modern letters and diaries in medieval schoolbooks indicate that leaving home was traumatic. Illiterate servants had no means of communicating with their parents, and the difficulties of travel meant that even if children were only sent 20 miles away, they could feel completely isolated. With that being said, childhood was considered over by the age of 12 for girls and the age of 14 for boys. Once children were considered adults, they were given more responsibilities and held accountable for their actions. Boys who weren't sent away usually started taking care of the agriculture and provide for family like their fathers. The ones who were sent away to other families were contractually obliged to behave. The new family takes on the formal role of guardian and promise to give food, teach the child his craft, and not punish them too severely for mistakes. For their part, children are not allowed to live without permission, steal, gamble, visit prostitutes, or marry. If they break the contract, the term of their apprenticeship would be double to 14 years. Although some aristocracy married in the teens, the population as a whole did not do so until they were in their mid-20s. Since from puberty until the mid-20s, there was a long period in which children were partly yet not fully independent, away from home but not in households of their own, like modern adolescents, they bonded with others of their own gender. leading in towns to the formation of gangs of youths and gradually made links with the opposite sex. Royals, on the other hand, more often than not, married in their early teens. The arrangement of marriage was done by the bride and groom's parents. In the Middle Ages, girls were typically around the age of 12-14 when they married, and boys were in their early 20s. The arrangement of the marriage was based on monetary worth, so it was not based on love. Most marriages were political arrangements. Husbands and wives were generally strangers until they first met. If love was involved at all, it came after the couple had been married. Even if love did not develop through marriage, the couple generally developed a friendship of some sort. How different was the childhood of Middle Ages from today's childhood? Are you glad you weren't born in the Middle Ages? What other similar topic would you like us to cover? Let us know in the comments below. And if you want to learn with what toys children in the Middle Ages entertained their free time, then check out this video. Thank you for watching.